Last week, we interviewed U of A College Republicans Chairwoman Emily Phillips about her controversial tweets in the aftermath of the January 6th riots. Now, we turn to the other side of the aisle to speak to the leader of the Young Democrats, Billy Cook. We've had them both on the show, but now Billy is asking for Emily to be held accountable. Our exclusive interview with Billy Cook starts right now. This is Campus Crossfire. Welcome back to Campus Crossfire. I'm your host, Tristan Hill. Back in January, when Emily Phillips tweeted, quote, "Notice these protests aren't after the Americans or American businesses, but at the steps of the snakes themselves. That's the difference. Stop fighting each other and start fighting them," end quote. The U of A Young Democrats were quick to respond, posting a call on social media for the college Republicans to hold their chairwoman responsible for, quote, "her support of this attempted coup." Last week, Emily Phillips told us on Crossfire that she had lost a lot of respect for Young Democrats leader Billy Cook for his response to the controversy. I sat down with Billy Cook just days after my interview with Emily Phillips, and he commented on the State of the Union and has some specific calls to action for Emily Phillips. Let's take a look. Welcome back to Crossfire. I'm joined now in studio by University of Arkansas Young Democrats President Billy Cook. Billy, thanks for being here, taking the time out of your day. A lot has happened since we talked last, you know, yeah. There's been a lot going on, so I'm glad you're here so we can get into some of it. I think last time we spoke was on the phone. We did some breaking coverage on January 6th about the Capitol, right?
Yes.
Okay. So I guess that's the best place to start, really. Take me back to January 6th, specifically on Twitter, from your point of view. You know, what happened?
So about the riot itself?
Yeah, and then just the controversy following. Just give me the whole story. Let's hear it from your point of view.
Yeah, so we had known for a while that January 6th was going to be a very big day for Republicans because the president ahead of time had announced that on January 6th there was going to be a big protest, was going to be wild, was the word that the president used. And then he amassed a gigantic crowd of people in Washington, D.C. on the 6th, the same day they were certifying the Electoral College votes. And the president made, along with others, Rudy Giuliani and others, made a very inflammatory speech telling them to fight, to go to the Capitol, to make their voices heard against what they thought was a stolen election. And so they did. We know they entered the Capitol. They were looking for members of Congress to potentially harm. They were looking for Mike Pence to see if he could overturn the election single-handedly. They threatened. They were live tweeting Nancy Pelosi's location to rioters. And we saw how the Capitol was ransacked. We saw how five people died as a result of this. And so seeing this on Twitter, seeing everyone react to this, because everyone was watching this, I saw Emily's tweet about, her wording was, notice how they're not going against American businesses or American institutions, really, even though they were attacking the U.S. Capitol building, and that they were at the steps of the snakes themselves, which is very interesting wording to describe U.S. politicians. In her interview, she noted that she was trying to criticize corrupt politicians. Well, I wonder which political alignment she would say most of the corrupt politicians fall alongside, but also, she mentioned that it was meant more of a call to action to unite and to fight against these corrupt politicians. But this was a very interesting day to say something like that. When you're a Republican, after a mob of Republicans, white supremacists, militia members, a really loose coalition of the far right, entered the Capitol to overturn the election. And I was disturbed by this, and a lot of people were disturbed by this. And so we thought it right to call Emily out for making this tweet, because this wasn't just a random Republican on Twitter staking their opinion about this. This was a Republican that was elected by other Republicans to represent them. This was someone in a leadership position, someone who is the head of the Republican presence on the largest campus in this state. So words coming from someone like that absolutely matter, and they deserve to be put under scrutiny.
So Do you stand by the initial reaction? Do you feel like it was too harsh? Do you think it was not harsh enough? You know, because I, as we noted on Twitter, I mean, you can't go back and find the threads now because she's since deleted her entire account. But lots of people responded to her in pretty quick succession. So do you think that was excessive or not enough? And like, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth. I'm genuinely asking. You know, I really do want to know what your take on the entire discussion essentially was.
So I think our reaction as the Young Democrats was appropriate in asking the college Republicans to hold their leadership accountable for making statements like this. As for the reactions of other people who were likewise shocked, there were a lot of emotions on January 6th. It has been called worse than a riot. It has been called an insurrection. It's been called a coup. It's been called an act of treason. And those are very powerful words to use, especially when we're talking about a presidential election that is so important. And I'm more concerned with how the college Republicans themselves reacted to this criticism, in that there was no accountability that was even offered up. There was no chance to even apologize. There was no attempt to really even see it from the other side's point of view. It was really just a succession of people doubling down on Emily. Emily herself doubled down on what she said and defended what she said in her interview, which I think is indicative of what we see in the Republican Party. There is a long track record of Republican politicians that don't hold each other accountable. And I think this is something we're seeing at all levels of the Republican Party. And so that reaction from them was really disturbing, in that they didn't even take up our accusations or our requests for accountability.
Mm-hmm. So correct me if I'm wrong, but it sounds like a lot of where the issue comes in from speaking to Emily and now speaking to you is the reactions of other people who might or might not be affiliated with the Young Democrats, but not from the call for accountability from the Young Democrats organization as a whole. Would you say that's fair?
Yes. Emily has also attributed a lot of the reaction to cancel culture, mm-hmm. and has said that conservatives face a lot of backlash for their views, which I have a lot of reason to dispute that, because you're a conservative in Arkansas, which is probably one of the best states in the country to be a conservative. Conservatives control our government at just about every level, down to the local level. And you have a platform if you are a Republican in Arkansas. People will listen to you. You are in the majority. So people criticizing you for your views doesn't make you oppressed or singled out when you're in the majority. It just means that you posted something publicly and now people are opening that up to scrutiny.
So it sounds like you would say that it's less about her overall views or principles that she stands by, and more about how they kind of intertwined with the situation at hand on January 6th.
Yeah, and I would like to add that it's not cancel culture. We're not trying to just ostracize people at will. It's accountability culture. We have to hold people in leadership positions accountable. We understand that the road to reconciliation starts with accountability, and after reconciliation comes unity. But we have to have people willing to say, what I said was wrong. I understand the implications of what I said, and I understand how it could have hurt others, or how it could have led others to believe that what I said wasn't representative of who I am or my organization. But there wasn't really any of that. Instead, we just saw them once again double down on what they said, like they were proud of it.
So it sounds like what you would rather see more than anything is an apology of some sort, rather than trying to have her, for example, or anybody else bullied off of social media or something like that. You're looking for recognition of the points made and the counterpoints, rather than stirring up controversy, essentially, since that's kind of what ultimately happened.
Yeah, and condemning the violence after the fact doesn't really retroactively make you holding yourself accountable either, I don't think.
So I do want to talk about that a little bit, because we do have to, I feel like, for me, I have to acknowledge that while the violence was taking place, I spoke with her on the phone right after I spoke with you on the phone. Mm-hmm. And the very first words that she said to me were that she and her organization condemned the violence. And to be honest with you, I'm not 100% sure of the timeline. If that was before or after the tweet, you might know better than me. But how do you think that connects to this interaction as a whole? Do you feel like her condemnation was too little too late, or did it go unnoticed? What would you say it was?
To that, I would pose two questions. First, why did she still tweet that, even after condemning the violence? I don't remember exactly when it was tweeted. If it was after the condemnation, that would make it worse. But also, secondly, this was around the same time that the president himself happened to condemn the violence. But in the same breath, he posted a video on Twitter calling the rioters special and saying he loved them. So I am skeptical about how sincere these condemnations of violence are.
Yeah. So, what would you like to see the college Republicans do? Is there something they could do at this point to make it right?
I think it's going to start with recognition from the college Republicans that what they did was wrong, and then we can start a dialogue of what accountability looks like. But I mean, it's not the job of the young Democrats to have to police another political organization. Of course, we're here to hold them accountable, and we're here to be the pushback and to be the opposition, but they are an organization of grown adults. They should be able to hold themselves and their leadership accountable. It's just a matter of getting them to recognize that what was said was wrong.
And coming up, the final minutes of my interview with Billy Cook. We'll be right back.
I'll never forget the day our landlord called and said, "Read your lease. No pets allowed." My owner tells him my dog ate the lease, but that didn't work. And now I'm stuck in a shelter, but this pit bull is ready for a new crib. I'm loving, loyal, and play well with others. So don't be intimidated by all my muscles, because the biggest one I have is my heart. That's right, I said it.
Want to call those hogs at your favorite sporting event? No can do.
So if you lose me, you could be paying that $18 replacement fee yourself.
Protect your life on campus from mayhem with your student ID card.
A lot of people call us handlers and caretakers, and that's okay. And then some people say we're owners, but we are not owners. All Razorback fans everywhere, all over the world, own a little piece of him. We just see after his day-to-day activities and well-being and take care of him. Touch 4 has retired. He is now in retirement mode in retirement home, so he just plays in the mud and still gets some grapes, but just not as much belly rubbing as he used to get. We've picked out Tuss 5, and you pick him out for how he interacts with people, how he interacts with fans, and things like that. You want him to have a good disposition type. He's going to be very active, a little spastic, a little running around. Got a great personality. Of course, this mud hole is the number one thing he likes to do. And I've had some people say, you know, how does it feel to pull in a stadium with 75,000 people screaming? And I said, the first thing you got to remember is they're not screaming at you. They're screaming what's in that trailer. The thing that I really enjoy is when the fans come up and the little kids come up and their eyes just get big as silver dollars, because they just can't wait to see Tuss. But I've had people come back to me and say, I still remember my first Razorback game, but the only thing I remember is Tuss. I don't remember if we won or lost, but I can remember meeting him. It just gives me a way. I feel like I can give back to a state that's given me so much.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Campus Crossfire. For those of you just now tuning in, last week I sat down with President of the Young Democrats, Billy Cook, to discuss the January Capitol riots and College Republican Chairwoman Emily Phillips' controversial tweets. Now let's take a look at the final moments of our interview.
So what about unity moving forward? Because she used the term unity a lot. And to me, it sounds like what you're saying is that unity can't coincide with some of the statements made in the past due to them being inflammatory or inciting violence, things like that. So unless they do reconcile, is unity possible to you, in your opinion?
Well, they're the ones that are still left with the job of recognizing that what they did was wrong. The Young Democrats are going to continue doing the work we do, whether or not they apologize or make any attempt to recognize that what they said was wrong. And it's not just the tweet about the Capitol that was disturbing about what was said by Emily. In Monday's interview, she said very inflammatory statements, yes. For instance, she denied that systemic racism exists, which I believe you would have to be living under a rock, especially in the last year alone that we have all experienced collectively as a nation, to believe that systemic racism does not exist. And in the same breath, she turned around and said that there was a race war happening, which I don't know what she meant by that, but she did say this in the interview. But even using phrasing like that, even if you didn't mean it in an intentionally malign manner, that still has an extremely negative connotation, and you can't use phrases like that colloquially.
So would you say that something that you would like to emphasize is the importance of language, you know, because what we saw a lot of in the last interview was she had to correct herself and explain her statement. So do you think the language that people use initially can have damaging effects?
Absolutely. I don't think you could look at the last year alone and say that words don't matter. You can't look at what the president said before the Capitol riot and say words don't matter. This is on top of other things she said in the interview. She said she doesn't want her children to be taught that boys can be girls and girls can be boys, and that boys aren't boys and girls aren't girls, and that it's not okay to be white, implying that there's some anti-white curriculum going on in schools, saying something that is flagrantly transphobic and insulting. Like we said, this is the head of the College Republicans on the largest campus in the state saying this, denying the dignity of the trans community on camera. So what are we supposed to do with this?
I want to shift gears a little bit now. I want to talk about the screenshot that was posted by, I believe it was the Young Dems District 3 account that shared the tweet that, to be completely honest, was racist, and she even acknowledged that it was racist in the previous interview, but she denies that she tweeted it. What's your response to that?
So she also mentioned that she had a transcript from Twitter that contained all of her tweets, and I don't know if she deactivated her account or if she deleted it, but if she just deactivated it, she could reactivate it and get another transcript if she needs to. But if these tweets aren't on the transcript, then there's nothing to hide. And so I would challenge her to release that transcript and put this to rest if we have to. But we have multiple people who can corroborate seeing that tweet. I myself saw that tweet. We have multiple screenshots of that tweet. So really, if the transcript was released, we would be able to put all of this to rest. But because the account is deactivated or deleted, we can't access it right now.
Right. And that's the issue that I've had, because before any of this series of interviews started and all, the account was already deactivated. So I went and tried to look for it, and I wasn't able to find it. So I have no intention to say whether or not it is or isn't real, because I don't have that evidence myself. But it sounds like you do have your own evidence to corroborate sharing that screenshot.
Well, so does she, apparently. If she has this transcript, which shows no evidence of these tweets, then release it by all means, and vindicate yourself. But I don't understand why the Young Democrats would go to such length to openly fabricate tweets against someone. And just accusing them of being outright fabrications is, I think that's done in poor faith. Like, we just can't allow someone to deny what they said and then basically say it's fake news and then not release a transcript about it either. So I would once again challenge her to release that.
Yeah, so the way that I'm seeing this whole interaction, it's I'm kind of picturing it as a microcosm of the grander scheme of politics in the nation, right? We're seeing this kind of discourse across the country. It's not by any means exclusive to this campus. So on a national level, what would you say, now that President Biden has taken office and called for unity, what would you say is the best way to move forward?
I think accountability is the best way to move forward. I mean, we have an ex-president who still refuses to say he lost the election. We have Republican members of Congress, like Marjorie Taylor Greene, who has said despicable and horrific things, has denied that 9/11 happened at the Pentagon, has denied the Parkland shootings and the Sandy Hook shootings, has sent some very anti-Semitic conspiracy theories as well. And last night, the House Republican Conference didn't do anything to her. They didn't even try to take her off the Education or Budget Committee. And we see this lack of accountability across the Republican Party with people like Ted Cruz and Josh Hawley, who weren't held accountable for their role in participating in overturning the election. They said vehemently that they would not vote to certify the election. And they had a role to play in the Capitol riot. And so do all of these Republicans that don't hold each other accountable. What is it going to take to give to have the Republican Party hold its members accountable?
So, with all of that said, what do you see moving forward? Would you be willing to speak to Emily, say, on this show again in the future if we were to bring you both on at the same time like we have in the past? Are we beyond reconciliation in that regard, or are you willing to debates if she is? You know, where's the line, I guess, is my question.
After hearing everything in Monday's interview, especially the denying of systemic racism and denying the dignity of the trans community and all these accusations against the Young Democrats' honesty, I feel very wary of taking the stage with Emily again, because I feel like that discussion wasn't necessarily done in good faith. And I would ask her to at least recognize that what she said was inflammatory, that she should issue an apology for these things. I wouldn't hold my breath on that happening. Emily seems very, very stalwart in her beliefs. But I don't know if I could take the stage with someone who has said things like this, and who also said that the Young Democrats are social media warriors who have nothing better to do with our lives. And that's just a really insulting thing to say. We asked for accountability, and they accuse us of being liars and said that we basically have nothing better to do than do that. And that's really insulting, because the Young Democrats are actually out doing community service right now. We are actually out flyering to help halt evictions. And we have helped halt several evictions so far. We have knocked thousands of doors in the past few weeks. And so I would like to know what the college Republicans are up to these days. I'd love to know if they're also out there rolling up their sleeves and hitting the pavement like we are, because the Young Democrats are community service oriented. We want to build up those around us. And that also includes accountability also.
Yeah, so Emily had the opportunity to make a final statement essentially in her interview. And I want to present you with the same opportunity if there's anything that you, any message that you would like to leave, anything like that. Now is as good a time as any to do it.
Well, in Emily's final statement, she said she had lost a lot of respect for me, which it's politics. If people don't insult you or say they lose respect for you, you're probably doing something wrong. You're probably not standing up for what's right, I think. And I really don't have the time to worry about what people who say transphobic things and racist things care about me. I really don't have time to worry about these things. So I'm sorry that she has lost respect for me, but we have work to do. We have to get out in the community. We have to keep electing the right people. We have to keep being a part of our campus community. So as far as the lack of respect goes, that's an afterthought for me. So what I would like to put forward is that the Republican Party is at a crossroads right now. It's being eaten alive from the inside by conspiracy theorists who very clearly have leveraged a lot of authority within Congress to the point to where even the House Minority Leader does nothing to hold people accountable like that. And I think this is not the party of traditional old conservatism anymore. It is quickly becoming a QAnon party in a lot of ways, and that's really scary. That's really frightening to see the next generation of the Republican Party coming up to say these things openly on the floor of the House of Representatives, to have swaths of the Republican Party, members of the Republican Party, invade the U.S. Capitol building and chant things like "Hang Mike Pence," their own vice president, and who knows what they would have done if they had gotten a hold of a Democratic member of Congress. So I just hope the Republican Party doesn't bring the country down with it in a lot of ways. But also, I'm just really disturbed by so much of this wild rhetoric from the right that really defames a lot of groups, that really hurts a lot of people, and we need to be really concerned about the platforming of these people, the platforming of really dangerous ideas, the platforming of people that support insurrections, who claim the election was a hoax, that it was rigged, that Biden winning was a hoax, that there are Satanists in the Democratic Party, that's all of that is just afterthought. It's just so mind-boggling to think of. And the platforming of these things is really, really difficult to justify, I think, in a lot of ways. And we need to hold those who platform these things under scrutiny as well.
All right, definitely. Billy, thank you for being here. We genuinely really do appreciate your analysis and work on shows in the past, and we hope that you'll continue to come around and give us your insight on Crossfire in the future. We do exist to give the discourse that happens on this campus a voice, and so without all the people that get involved with our show, we wouldn't have that. You know, that's what we stand to do. And so thank you for being here once again. All right, be sure to stick around. That concludes the interview with Young Democrats President Billy Cook. Crossfire, we'll be right back.
I'll never forget the day our landlord called and said, "Read your lease. No pets allowed." My owner tells him my dog ate the lease, but that didn't work. And now I'm stuck in a shelter. But this pit bull is ready for a new crib. I'm loving, loyal, and play well with others. So don't be intimidated by all my muscles, because the biggest one I have is my heart. That's right, I said it.
That's all for Campus Crossfire tonight. Thanks for tuning in. We're thankful to Billy Cook for his time, and be sure to follow us on social media at UA Crossfire. I'm your host, Tristan Hill. Have a great night.